Did you just burp?
No.
Did you just burp?
No, I told you don't start yet.
Gross.
I wasn't ready.
Too bad.
Oh, no. Start over.
Welcome back to Summer's Off.
We're back.
Christmas episode.
Yeah.
Hey, what do you want for Christmas?
What do I want for Christmas?
Yeah.
Oh, boy. Let's get into it. I want a vaccine, like, today.
Oh, I told you one thing I didn't want to talk about was COVID or politics now that we're back. I joked around. I was like, the first thing Rachel will say is, like, Biden won. Suck it, everybody. Well, I'll tell you what I want for Christmas.
No one's asking.
Well, thank you for asking, our adoring audience.
What do you want?
I want a light-up sleigh in our front yard, and I want, like, a blow-up Santa Claus. Like one of those inflatables. Like, I want it really big.
Mm-hmm.
Like, really big. Like, over a story tall. Not two stories like that one we saw recently. But I want a big inflatable. And then I want a bunch of reindeer that are dressed up very nice, like almost in tuxedos.
Like the light-up reindeer?
Yeah, I want them to light up, but I want them during the day so you can really make out the tuxedos. And then at night, they just, like, look lit up and more charming.
I don't know that we have the yard space for this,
Well,
babe.
We do have a yard space for that. We can have all those things.
I got that burp out.
Gross. Burp out of the podcast.
I just had to get it out. I'm ready now. Are you ready to start?
Yeah, let's go. Okay, hey, everybody. Welcome back. Well, if you haven't tuned into us for a while, we took a little hiatus because summer was on.
Summer? Wait. No.
Work was on.
Work was on.
Summer was no longer off. And so we had to go back to school and work.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And if you don't know what we do in this podcast, then we do little movie reviews. We show each other movies that we've never seen before, that the other person has never seen before, usually. Sometimes there are movies that we both have witnessed, like today.
Today is our Christmas special.
This is our Christmas special.
It's technically one that we have both seen, but it's such a Christmas classic that we had to do it.
Rach, let's not bury the lead. I think I used it right this time.
I think you did too.
Now, compared to our other Christmas episode that we've done, was this worse or better than Jingle All the Way?
Oh, I mean, this is a better movie than Jingle All the Way, but, I mean, Jingle All the Way is...
classic.
Iconic, especially if you live anywhere near the Twin Cities.
Uh-huh.
It's just, it needs to be seen.
Yeah.
It really does.
Yep. I think the most iconic scene in that whole movie is when the Santa Clauses all fight Arnold Schwarzenegger. So, like, if you're going to just watch one scene in that movie, go watch that one. That's classic.
That's the
grade
one
A.
That you would pick.
Grade A.
Oh,
Rach, what movie do we watch this week?
We watched Die Hard.
With not a vengeance yet, because that's the third one.
There are rules for policemen.
Yeah. That's what my captain keeps telling me.
Rach, have you seen all the Die Hard movies?
No, I've only seen this Die Hard.
Oh, you haven't seen any of the other ones?
I don't think so.
Okay, so...
how many are there?
Five?
Five.
Yeah, five. Yep.
Boy.
Well, I'll give you Rotten Tomatoes scores that are associated with each one as we get along in the episode. But, I mean, they're very, like, kind of hit or miss.
I kind of was guessing that. I feel like you're going to have some stinkers, and then you're going to have some ones like Die Hard 3, which is just everyone's favorite. Maybe I have that backwards. But, you know, it's one of them that's going to be like, wow, that was actually very well done.
Sure.
Are they all Bruce Willis as the lead?
They are.
Wow.
They are. This is Bruce's series right here.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
He rules the roost.
His franchise, if you will.
Now, if there are some crazies out there who have never seen... I was going to say Lethal Weapon, but we're going to talk a lot about Lethal Weapon today,
too. Oh, we are?
Well, this series, they're so joined at the hip. Like, you have to talk about both of them. You can't just concentrate on one.
It's true. If you haven't, listeners, check out our Lethal Weapon episode, because we do mention Die Hard a couple of times.
Yep. This episode is going to really complement our Lethal Weapon episode. So I would suggest watching both movies back-to-back and then listening to both episodes back-to-back. It'll only take you... 6 hours?
Yeah, I would
That's
actually...
That's only a movie and a half of Lord of the Rings.
I would actually not recommend doing that, because if you're like me, action movies, you start to zone out a bit. And so I would give it a day. It like a solid beat between the two. Otherwise, you might get like a little like over explosions and fights and stuff. And you might like miss all the cool stuff because you've seen too much.
Now, I could tell there was a moment, just like in every action movie we watch, there was a moment you were very into it.
Mm-hmm.
And then you didn't have the telltale signs, though, that I've called you on the podcast before, where you start playing with Giz or you, like, check your phone and do stuff. Or, like, I don't know. You always do, like, little distracting behaviors. I didn't see the distracting behaviors today, which bodes well, I think, for the film.
Mm.
But I did notice there was a point in time where I was like, ooh, she's a little over this. It was when it got really loud. There was a lot of machine gun fire.
Yeah, it was so loud.
And it was just like exchanging machine gun fire mm-hmm. for like 5 minutes. There was a moment where I was like, oh, we're losing Rach.
Well, I just feel bad because Giz is watching it with us. And I just think that has to be so loud for her poor little ears. It was hurting my ears.
Well,
so
we're
going to
talk about why it was so loud, too.
Oh, really?
That's a thing.
That's a thing.
That is a thong girl.
And listeners, this is why you listen to this podcast, to find out what the thongs are.
Gotta find out the thongs. So, those crazies out there who have not seen this movie, what would you tell them? Rach, what's Die Hard about?
I guess I would ask them, have you seen Lethal Weapon? It's not that movie.
Oh, okay.
Because you might get confused, because a lot of times, if you're like me, this, Beverly Hills Cop, it all kind of like blends itself.
Your two main male characters
are cops.
Are cops,
on
and one's white and one's black. So like,
yeah.
that is a thing. Mm-hmm. But I mean, the black cop in this movie is a much smaller role than in Lethal Weapon.
This is true.
Yeah,
this is true.
Danny Glover said a lot more.
Yeah. So to wrap it up with a little bow on it, we've got Bruce Willis and his wife, kind of estranged wife. He's mm-hmm. coming to visit her in L.A. where she has moved because she got this big job at this big company.
By the way, you just said a word that I want to just jump in. So the word estranged.
Oh, okay.
When I was younger.
Where are we going?
Anyone who knows me knows that I mess up words all the time. Like, I thought chasm was pronounced chasm. I mm-hmm. thought epitome was epitome. Mm-hmm. Like, these are things that I do. I call them tie-isms. I thought the word estranged was estranged.
Oh, yeah.
I thought estranged wouldn't make any sense. Because that's strange.
That's ridiculous.
That's another word. It's estranged.
Why would you add a prefix onto an existing
that
word?
It doesn't mean anything about being strange. It's being like almost divorced or separated.
Uh-huh. Gosh, I love this.
There's a little tidbit for you.
Listeners, this is also why you listen to this podcast. Lo and behold, the night that he goes to this office party to meet his estranged wife, it gets taken over by a bunch of German terrorists. And I have to say that they're German because that's very important to the characters that are in it, our actors.
And in 1988, the Germans were our biggest enemies.
Is that really right?
Not at all. I think it even says they're Western Germany terrorists,
oh, really?
Which is like, why aren't they Eastern Germany?
Don't have
like that's the Russian
them.
Side. Like,
at least be the right
why
side.
Why do we care about the Western side?
I didn't remember that. Somehow he is not held up in the ransom group. He gets kind of away from it, and he, being a cop, Bruce Willis,
mm-hmm.
Is able to kind of finagle and like toy with the terrorists and
kind of
picks them off one by one until you're just gonna have to wait and see. It's fun. It's a good time.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It is. It is a good time. And it kind of follows that 80s action movie formula big time. And mm-hmm. I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing because I think it does it so well.
Mm-hmm. I would agree.
When was the first time you saw this movie? Because I was a late bloomer to this film. I think I saw this after Lethal Weapon. So for me, it
would
was
that have been?
Probably like early college. We mm-hmm. had it. And I remember even as a kid, I put it in for the VHS in one time. And I started watching it. I made it like 10 minutes in, which is not a whole lot of explosions in the first 10 minutes.
Mm-mm.
And I fell asleep.
Yeah, I could see that.
And so as a kid, it never was a part of my repertoire.
Just too much exposition.
Too much exposition for me. Let's put in Homeward Bound or Three Ninjas where we can get to the action.
Love it. Well, so the first time I saw this movie, and this is actually, I think this is a story I have shared a couple of times on the podcast, so to spice it up a little bit, I'm going to say it with
backwards
in an accent, so that it's a bit more interesting.
Okay.
So the first time I saw this movie, I was studying abroad in Spain, and when I was in Spain, my friend's family had us over to watch a movie, Jungla de Cristal.
Oh, Jungla de Cristal, that's right, you have told
the story. I saw this movie in Spanish the first time. So, I get most of it, I think.
Jungla de Cristal.
Crystal Jungle.
The Crystal Jungle. Yeah, I kept calling it something different. I think this was on, I don't know, remember which podcast it was. I think it was maybe Predator. Was this our first episode?
What?
Where you were talking about Jungla de Cristal?
I probably talked about this right off the bat. A couple of times, which is why I had to spice it up a little bit and sound super pretentious.
Well, I liked it. It was good.
Thank you.
So you've never seen this movie in English?
I did see it in English like 2 years ago, I think with your family. I think we watched it at Christmas time. So I knew the gist of the story because I think when I watched it, it also had subtitles, but...
You guys missed this. I called Rach out about how she watches movies sometimes at our house when like a movie like Die Hard or Lord of the Rings is on for the 18,000th time. She'll like not pay attention at all. She'll like disappear for long portions of time. She like comes up. She's like always reading magazines. So when she says she watched it at my house, she didn't really watch it. So
attacked.
It had been a while.
Attacked.
Geronimo, motherfucker.
All right, Rach. Well, let's get into the flickeroo. Believe it or not, this is based on a book.
What?
Yeah, I know. It seems very odd that this would be based on a book.
Oh, that's fantastic.
But it was. It's based actually on Sense and Sensibility by Jane Austen.
No.
Yeah, it is.
No, it's not.
Yeah.
No, it's not.
McClane is Eleanor. And then the black cop from Not Step by Step or Family Matters, he plays Marianne. You know, he's a little more passionate. Mm-hmm.
You're just trying to do a plug for the show that you're going to be in soon.
Oops.
A little Oops. Self-promoting. Ty's going to be on Sense and Sensibility. Maybe. We don't know. COVID.
Yeah, if it doesn't get shut down.
It very well could be shut down.
No, it's actually based on a 1979 crime novel called Nothing Lasts Forever.
Ooh.
Yeah, did you like that little echo? I just programmed that. We have an engineer now in the small closet with us. They do a bunch of effects.
I forget his name. Like, what's his name?
His name is Hans, actually.
Hans.
Yeah. Yep.
Thanks, Hans.
Yep.
The fly in the ointment, Hans. The monkey in the wrench. The pain in the ass.
And it has almost the exact same plot.
Oh, really?
Yeah, like there's hardly any changes. Mm-hmm. Like it truly is based on this book. And that book was influenced by a movie. So a movie influences a book that then influences a movie called The Towering Inferno.
Wow.
Now, this isn't going to be one of those, Rich, tell me what Towering Inferno is about. But what do you think The Towering Inferno is about?
I mean, I would imagine it's a really tall building that's on fire, similar to, at one point, this building that they're in LA is exploding and is on fire on top of it. But you're going to tell me...
No, you're pretty much right.
Yeah?
Only there's a bunch of terrorist guys running around chasing a guy who's shooting at him the entire movie.
Very good.
Like, that's the whole plot.
Hmm.
So they stole it from that. And
it's so cyclical.
Yeah, I know, right? This movie is actually, even though it's Die Hard 1 and you have 5 total.
Yes.
This movie's a sequel.
What?
Yes.
What?
This movie is considered a sequel.
To what?
A sequel to a movie called The Detective, which starred Frank Sinatra, came out in the 70s.
Oh.
And the studio and the writer, like, everything was the same. And so they take place, they're, like, different stories, but they take place, I guess, in the same universe. Like, the Marvel universe.
Whoa.
Yeah. And so it's all part of the same, like, yeah, storyline. So Die Hard is a sequel. And kind of an interesting thing, too, like, with casting, when they first made this movie... I'll have to look up how old Frank Sinatra was. I think he was like, he's 73 years old. And they had to contractually offer him the role of John McClane because of how the contracts worked out and because he was in The Detective. They had to offer him the sequel.
Wow.
And he was 73 and he was like, this doesn't seem like a role made for me anymore. So he turned it down.
But
it's still, he could have done it.
Just pause for a moment and imagine.
Who would that be like taking on like a big action role right now? At, like, the age of 73, like a John McClane type role, though.
I don't know. Alan Arkin?
Sure. Yeah. Oh yeah. Or like Clint Eastwood doing it now. But Clint Eastwood's so badass. I think he could probably pull it off.
He probably could do it. Yeah. Yeah. That's a bad example. That's incredible.
Yeah. Yeah. And Clint Eastwood. Speaking of Clint Eastwood.
What?
Whoa.
Whoa.
I didn't even realize that. I looked down at my form. I'm like, Clint Eastwood.
You're getting too good at this.
He owned the movie rights mm-hmm. to this movie. That was, you know, called Nothing Lasts Forever but it ends up being called Die Hard. But he owns the movie rights and plans on making the movie like the whole first half of the 80s. Mm-hmm. He just never gets around to getting a script written for it, and he was going to star and produce it. He was busy. Mm-hmm. But he could have been John McClane as well.
That would have been very believable as well. He also strikes me as a John McClane type,
yep.
for sure.
Yeah. Only everything would be like this. Hans, I'm coming for you. Now, can you remind our listeners anything that you remember about the Mel Gibson versus Bruce Willis thing with Lethal Weapon and Die Hard? Like, what do you remember from that whole thing? And I can clarify for you.
I think I recall that both of them were offered essentially each other's roles in mm-hmm. their opposite movies, and both of them decided that those ones weren't the ones that they yeah. wanted, even though, again, this is very similar. There's no reason from an acting range standpoint that either of them couldn't have fallen into either of these characters' footsteps.
Can you imagine if one of those guys would have done both roles?
I mean,
like, wouldn't that have been yeah. freaking crazy?
Yeah, but then you couldn't keep doing, like, one of them would have suffered. You wouldn't be able to yeah. have the franchises
because they
both
would
have survive.
Be like, oh, Die Hard's or Lethal Weapon, either one's a lesser version of the other one.
Right. Yeah. Well, and they just wouldn't have, like, you wouldn't have four of each of them if they're all going to be Mel Gibson,
yeah,
right? It's
that's
like, wait,
true.
Which Mel Gibson is this? I can't tell. Yep. You know, like, mm-hmm. it wouldn't work. So it had to be a different guy, but it was essentially the same guy, if
sure.
that makes sense.
No, for sure. Like, mm-hmm. character-wise,
yeah.
so similar. Yeah. I mean, I guess Mel's character is a little more, like, psychotic and, like, suicidal.
Mel has more hair, too.
He has
that's
more hair. Yep.
Normality.
Let's get into it. Let's jump right in.
Okay.
Who do you want to hook up with more between Mel Gibson and Lethal Weapon in his luscious locks or Bruce Willis in his dirty tank top? Like, oh. who do you want more?
He does have such a dirty tank
Dirtiest
top.
Dirtiest tank top in the game.
Yeah. I mean, unfortunately, Bruce doesn't get a costume change in this. He just gets sweatier and bloodier and dirtier
yep.
as because it all takes place within one night.
Mm-hmm.
With Lethal Weapon, you have, like, weeks, I think, probably.
Truth.
Or
yep.
at least a week. I don't know. Well, it's tricky.
It's tricky,
It's
huh?
tricky if you're giving me like an 80s version of both
yeah,
of
I'm
them.
Yeah, I'm talking about them in those two movies.
Yeah, but
not
knowing
now.
But knowing what I know now, I think I still have to go with
don't
Bruce.
Don't let yourself
but...
be. Don't let yourself be.
I can't be seduced by him. I won't let it happen
those
again.
Those locks, though. Beautiful.
So, like a mane.
Yeah, it truly is. He's a lion. So they were offered each other's roles and they turned it down. You are correct. And a couple other people that were offered the Bruce Willis role, John McClane in Die Hard. Like, I don't know if you remember this with Lethal Weapon, too. It was like a crazy amount
mm-hmm,
of people.
Mm-hmm.
It's the same thing here. I'm just going to list off some of the people, and they're almost all the same as what you heard before.
Frank Sinatra.
Yep, Frank Sinatra. Clint Eastwood, kind of. So here are the list of people who all were offered and rejected mm-hmm. before. The other, for Lethal Weapon, it was like just guessed upon.
Sure.
But this is like legitimate. Sylvester Stallone.
Mm-hmm.
Harrison Ford,
mm-hmm.
Robert De Niro,
wow.
Nick Nolte, Richard Gere,
Burt
Reynolds, and Richard Dean Anderson. Do you know who that is?
No.
MacGyver.
Oh.
Can you imagine MacGyver in this movie?
Well, at least MacGyver will be better than Richard Gere. What action movie has Richard Gere ever done?
He was a cop in a movie, but I don't know if he did anything.
Yeah, but like detective cop versus like Bruce Willis action cop
That's
is very,
so true.
It's not the same. That's
yep.
more of like a mental thriller versus like yippee-ki-yay. You know, can you see
no,
Richard
not really.
Gere whispering that?
I can't at all. Nope, I can't. You're right. Now, Bruce Willis was not considered. Because Bruce Willis really was not a big deal in this era at all. The only thing that he was kind of lauded for
mm-hmm.
was he was in a show called Moonlighting. Have you ever heard of that show?
No.
Now, I kind of told you.
A TV show?
Yeah. And I guess we can kind of get into this. I was like, hey, I'm not going to talk about this on the podcast, but I'm going to talk about it now, I guess. We're going AWOL. So Moonlighting was like a hit show. It was like the Modern Family kind of its day. It won like multiple Emmys. Mm-hmm. He won Best Comedic Actor Emmy. And that's one of the reasons why he wasn't considered for Die Hard, is because he was seen as this huge comic actor.
Oh.
Come out to the coast. We'll get together. Have a few laughs.
But one of the reasons why we don't know Moonlighting, mm-hmm. and it was a huge deal in the 80s, is because it was not picked up for syndication. Because, folks, get this. For a TV show to be picked up by syndication, it has to have over 100 episodes, and Moonlighting only had like 50. So that's like why Arrested Development, it can't be picked up for syndication, because it has too little of episodes. I didn't know that was a thing.
I
thought you
either.
Could just pick a show up. You'd be like, yeah, I got this show.
Is it good? Let's watch it again.
Yep. But I guess all that has to happen is a show has to run for an extremely long amount of time, like Big Bang Theory or Two and a Half Men, and it can be picked up for syndication and shown all the time. And every time you go visit your parents, it's always on, and you want to blow up the TV.
I love the examples that you picked.
Well, those two are just see all the freaking time. But anyways, there was another movie that he had done before this, his first big feature film. We talked about it in, I think it was our Lethal Weapon episode, because it came out the second weekend of Lethal Weapon. Bruce Willis starred in this movie, and it took the top spot from Lethal Weapon. So we've talked about it before, and I asked you at that time, Rach, what is this movie about? Now, you didn't do very well the first time, but this is your chance to rock it. So Bruce Willis, before Die Hard, was in the movie with Kim Basinger. Do you know who that is?
Yep.
That man's a dead man. Yep, from Wayne's World, the white.
Sure.
Just in case you didn't know, guys. It's called Blind Date.
Oh, yes. I remember this movie.
Rage. This is your chance to redeem yourself. What is the movie Blind Date about?
Blind Date. So
go.
I think before I took it a bit literally, but this time.
Oh, yeah. I think you said somebody was blind in it.
I don't know.
Which was a good guess.
Oh, thank you.
It was a strong guess.
Oh, Blind Date, the movie with Bruce Willis. His first big, big role opposite.
Oh, my gosh. You've done a lot of research.
Kim Basinger. It was a romantic comedy.
Yes.
Yes.
It was.
Yes, it was. I'm telling you that.
Yep.
And, I think the title says a lot. They were set up as a blind date, and they hate each other, obviously, because why wouldn't you hate each other? They don't get along, and they drive each other nuts, and then they exchange emails over the course of
emails?
A couple of
this
months.
Came out in the 80s.
And then, or letters,
wait,
one of the two.
Are you giving the synopsis that you've got mail right now?
Am I? I felt like maybe that was rooted in Blind Date.
And what I'll say is, you nailed it, because it totally influenced You've Got Mail. I'm just kidding. You should see Rachel's face. She's like, what?
Wait, what?
No way.
Oh, cool.
Sorry, Hans, wrong guess.
No, it's about a guy sets his friend up with a blind date, and then she's really kind of awkward at the beginning, and then she starts drinking, and she goes nuts. Mm. She's like crazy. She's a crazy girl.
And it's romantic comedy?
Romantic comedy.
Sounds more like a thriller.
Yeah, I'm sure hijinks ensue. So he was seen as this comic actor, and that's the reason why he wasn't considered. But when they ended up taking him... Well, I want to go back to Moonlighting for a second, though.
Okay.
Moonlighting is known as one of the top... Will they or won't they shows? Do you know what I mean by that?
Yes.
What are some other will they or won't they shows?
How I Met Your Mother.
Yeah, it is actually.
I know.
Yeah.
And I know vicariously through you because you talk about that show every day you finish
like, Rach,
an episode.
Guess what happened?
Because you know that I'm probably not going to put in the time to watch it. So
but
I
you seem interested.
I just said, hey, just give me a little heads up.
What I'll say is you've done a good job of like seeming engaged.
Mm-hmm.
You might not care. But you've hidden it well. I'll tell you, Rach, this is what happened in the finale of season 8. And you'll be like, oh, cool. Really? Oh, wow. you do a good job. You're kind of like your middle school teacher pretends like she cares when you're like, I'm going to write a paper about the Roman Empire.
oh,
cool.
Wow.
That's great, Ty. Good luck. And I just appreciate it because I don't think I would be the same. If you're like, yeah, guess what happened in this show?
Let me clarify for you. You are not the same. Nor have you ever been the same.
Well, I'll try to be better. That's going to be my Christmas pledge.
I love it.
Yep. I will try to be better. Some other ones would be like Friends, right? Friends would be one.
Will they, won't they?
Yep. I don't know.
Just a lot.
Just a lot.
Grey's Anatomy. I mean, really.
The OC.
The OC, yep.
Lost? Lost is kind of will they or won't
they?
They don't always have to be comedies. They can be dramas.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty much every good show. So back to Willis. When they chose Willis, He made more money than almost every star in Hollywood at the time for this movie.
Yippee-ki-yay, motherfucker.
He got a paycheck of $5 million.
Dang.
To compare this to the top male actors of this time period were Tom Cruise and Michael J. Fox. Yeah. They both were only making $3 million a feature. And so after this movie gets made, and Bruce Willis, this TV actor who hasn't had any like a success from a Hollywood perspective, well, from a film perspective, and he's making $5 million, the paychecks for everybody in Hollywood instantly bumped up to $5 million after this.
Wow. Yep.
And I don't know how he pulled it off, like if he was like a good negotiator or what. That's not given to me, but he raised the paychecks for everybody.
That's incredible.
So remember that when you go in to ask for more money for all the school psychs,
sure.
You're not just doing it for you.
It's not just for me.
Yeah, you're
it's
doing
for
it for everybody.
Everybody.
You say, I want 150K now.
Yeah. Take that.
Now, the role of Hans. Who's Hans, Rich?
Oh my God. I just blanked on his name.
Alan Rickman?
Thank you. Alan Rickman. Ugh, I love Hans. Hans Gruber, the head terrorist of the German, the West German gang, is the main bad guy.
Mm-hmm.
So he's holding all the hostages. He's on the radios playing mind games. I love those scenes.
Listen here, cowboy.
Yeah. I'll say Alan Rickman, love him. Yep. I think he's a fantastic villain. He's always the best.
For sure.
I don't know how I feel about the German. it comes in and
especially
out.
Especially when his German just sounds like Alan Rickman, Bruce Willis, cowboy. And so that's the problem. Like, I've got some things to tell you about the German stuff.
Oh, good.
We can get into it right now. Those German guys?
Yeah.
Do you know German very well?
Ja, sprechen Sie German.
Oh, yeah. I think we got some nines in there.
Nines.
But that's about it. Everything else they said? Was just Hobbit Snabbacle News. Let's go, Fassive Newman here.
Seriously? It was just made up.
Gibberish. It was all gibberish.
They couldn't even give them like real German things to say?
No. And get this. When the movie released in Germany, which was a huge market internationally,
sure.
They like changed some things. And because the guys weren't speaking German, they just made them from an indistinguishable European country
when it was
released in Germany.
Oh, boy.
And so, like, anybody who knows any German is like, oh, these guys aren't German.
Oh, my gosh.
So for the Europeans, they think that they're probably, like, Estonians or something.
Oh, those crazy Estonians.
Those guys are
jibber jabbering away.
God, I love the Bulgarians. Those guys are nuts.
I can't believe they couldn't even give them German things to say.
No.
It's not that hard.
Well, and they worked with Alan Rickman a lot on trying to disguise his accent because he goes American at one point in the movie, too.
Yeah,
he's like,
he disguises himself.
Hey there. Like, he just hangs on to his R's longer and it sounds horrible.
I know.
And the director worked with him over and over and over again to try to get his American to sound more legit. And he doesn't at all.
Just,
he sounds terrible.
I mean, he doesn't sound different in any movie, though.
No.
You think about his voice.
His vocal work is not what, yeah, it's not.
It's iconic.
Yeah,
you have to change to meet Alan Rickman where he is at.
Sure.
You can't expect him to all of a sudden transform into a German terrorist.
Mm-hmm.
Let him be his own terrorist.
Yep.
Let him be.
Yeah,
it.
We hate the Brits.
I mean, it could be an international group.
It's true.
This Brit could be running and have all of his mob guys be German.
They
That's
could be
fine.
Just based out of West Germany.
Yeah, sure.
He's like, oh, it's that old British expatriate who went to West Germany
instead
of that terrorist group.
Yeah, and he can still
group.
Speak German to them, but I just, yeah, but I love him.
Well,
still
I do too.
Him.
I think he's a tremendous actor. Like, his acting is wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
It's great. Now, one of the things about the role of Hans, though, it wasn't originally going to Rickman.
Oh.
It was going to Sam Neill. Does that name sound familiar to you?
No.
Sam Neill is the professor and main character in Jurassic Park.
The old guy?
Well, not the old guy.
Oh, the
not
younger.
Like,
the younger
like, welcome to my island.
Like the little grandpa
no,
Santa?
He's like, the guy is like, hey, he's not making him Australian.
No, but he looks like he would be Aussie,
he does,
right?
He does.
Yes, he's very attractive. He's like the main guy in Jurassic Park.
Yeah, so he was going to be Hans.
I like an attractive villain because then I'm conflicted.
Yeah.
I don't know how to feel about it.
You're like, oh, well, what if I could fall to his traps? I could transform him.
I could change him. Would he let me go? Because I'm cute, and I think he's cute, too.
Oh, my gosh. You're going to love Walk to Remember.
What?
The rebellious kid. You know, you think you can change him?
Oh, yeah. I was like, what tangent did you just dive off of?
Oh, yeah. I can't wait. Valentine's Day episode.
That would be a fun one.
Yep. So the reason why they went with Alan Rickman is because the director had saw him in a play. Saw him in Dangerous Liaisons.
Oh.
Yeah, and he played the main guy.
Yeah.
And sure it was did. Like, this is our guy. This is our Hans.
He's so evil.
Yeah, so he dug him. But apparently they didn't do a whole lot of dialect work to check and make sure that was all going to go through.
I can't. How hard is it just to, like, scooch a couple of, like, names around? Just, like, tweak it a little bit. How hard would that have been to come through and be like, you know what? Scratch the German bit. It's Alan Rickman. It'll be fine. Trust me.
It'll be okay.
Trust me.
Well, I also just wonder why they had to be German. Yeah. Just because we didn't want to have Russians again?
Hmm.
I don't know. We had Germans as villains forever, though, before that.
I know.
So,
it's like,
I don't know.
I was expecting it.
Sure.
Yeah?
Yep. I love all those guys' blonde hair, though. Like, they all... Well, and then I think it was a movie about the Axis. I want to talk about this right now.
Oh, this is a fun theory.
So I think it was a rejoining of the Axis. You had the Germans with long blonde hair. Mm-hmm. You had a couple guys with really dark hair. And I was like, the Italians.
Oh.
And then you had the one Asian guy. Who was the Japanese?
Japan. Yep.
It was the Axis reunited.
Got it.
Trying to take on America and stuff.
But I feel
money.
Like the company that she worked for was a Japanese.
It was
country.
A Japanese. Mm, yeah.
Just checking.
It was.
I'm just checking.
Yeah. There's like, there's been essays written about what this movie is really an attack on the Japanese trying to infiltrate our economic system through like corporate conglomeration and stuff. Like, there's some weird stuff I read.
Very
it was like,
fun.
Oh, this is what the movie really is about. And then the disenfranchised ruins of Europe trying to win back their monetary financial gains. So there's some high-minded concepts in this movie, just so you know.
Oh, I can tell.
Yeah, you could tell.
I can tell. Yep. Yippee-ki-yay.
America's winning again. Gotcha, Wales. So they couldn't find a person to play the wife.
Okay.
Which why'd you have a lot of struggle to play that character?
Kim Basinger was busy
doing... Yeah, I guess so. She's doing Blind Date 2. But Bruce Willis actually suggested the chick who plays it, Bonnie Bedelia. And she wasn't in a whole lot. She was in Salem's Lot, which you've never seen as a vampire scary movie.
Nope.
And
no, thank you.
Yep, Stephen King. And then she's like in Parenthood now, or was. I don't know if Parenthood's still going on, that TV show.
Yeah, I never watched it.
She's probably like an older mom in that care in that show
she's
or something.
Probably an old hag now.
Yeah, old grosso. But I kind of like that the love story is different than a lot of love stories in action movies. I like that it was him trying to reconnect with his wife and then being estranged. Rather than him like just meeting a girl and being like, oh, this chick's hot. And,
yeah,
like,
I'm gonna save her, princess.
Yeah. You know, mm-hmm. So I did like that it was like their reconnection was a central plot line of the movie. Mm-hmm. So I gave it a little bit of heart that I appreciated.
I agree with you 100%.
Yeah.
I think it makes it less cliche,
mm-hmm.
which is why I think it's a good movie.
But it made
but
it
we won't
more
get into it yet.
Nick Lachey. Because it's a less little surface level, kind of a little moronic at times.
I wonder what he's doing now.
Yeah, I know. Watch, Nick will be like my friend one day, and he'll be like, I heard what you said. There's lots of cameos in this movie, though. Like a crazy amount of rando people that you've seen in other movies.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like the dad from Family Matters.
Yep.
Who
Carl.
Plays the black cop, Carl.
I don't know.
Who's
Alan
also a cop in there.
Plays Alan in this.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. He's great.
And then there is the guy from The Goonies.
Yep.
Who plays the FBI.
The brother in Goonies or the bad guy brothers.
Who hangs himself at the beginning, one of the Fratelli brothers.
Yeah.
He's like the stronger one.
He's got like the pockmarked
come
face.
Ma. Nah, come here, ma. Yeah, he's got pockmarked face. Is that for you? Hey, come here, ma. Ma, come here, ma.
Yep, that guy, he's in it.
And then
who else?
Did you recognize the first cop who's kind of a dick, especially to Carl?
Yes.
What do you recognize him from?
He is the principal from Breakfast Club.
Yes. Or I think he's like the
assistant
physical
principal.
Ed teacher or something. Maybe he's a principal.
He's some sort of an admin.
Yeah. He's a dick.
In charge of detention.
Yep. And he's a dick in this too. So mm-hmm. he plays those dickheads really well.
I guess so.
And then there
just was... beaming with cameos.
Yep.
Like a list. Hollywood's who's who at the time was in this
if
film.
If you think of somebody, they were probably in this movie or one of the sequels. another crazy cameo.
Great. Who?
The Asian guy who's on the bad guy squad.
Yep, Japan.
Yep. He had Japan in the Axis.
Mm-hmm.
Who? How do you recognize him? What's he been in?
No, he fought though. So I'm.
What if I told you he's been in 3 movies that we've watched during Summer's Off?
Are you kidding?
I'm not kidding.
No. Okay, let me just start with backwards. How about Big Trouble Little China? Is he in that one?
Yes. He plays one of the... He's on the bad guy squad. He's in those guys with the black uniforms.
Okay.
So he's not one of the gods or anything.
Okay.
He's just like... There's 2 leaders of this foot gang or whatever that fights in the alley before the gods come down.
Mm-hmm.
He's one of the 2 leaders for the bad guy squad.
Got it.
Yep.
Okay, there's one.
Yep.
All right. Sorry, I just got to go in order of my stereotypes. Mortal Kombat?
No, he's not in
Mortal
Kombat.
He's not in Mortal Kombat?
Nope, but good... Hey, Rach, listen to me. Good guess.
Double Dragon.
Yes.
Yes.
Nailed it. He's Huey or Lewis. I don't remember which one. Huey? Lewis? Any news?
Listeners, go do yourselves a favor. Do yourself a Christmas favor.
Yes.
Go watch Double Dragon.
It takes
hour
20 minutes. It's almost the same size as like watching the Grinch movie or watching Charlie Brown Christmas.
Just
like, it's not going to take long.
Mix it up a little bit. It's a good time.
Yep.
I promise you will not be disappointed.
It's
I promise.
Summer's Off classic. And then the third movie. Well, this is, I mean, Die Hard becomes 4. The third movie, he tortures somebody.
Oh, is it Lethal Weapon?
Yes.
Gosh, he was having a heyday around.
He tortures Mel Gibson, and then Mel Gibson, I think, breaks his neck with his legs.
Hell yeah, he does.
So this guy made the rounds in movies, especially movies that we would review in Summer's Off.
Yeah.
Like, maybe that's his whole filmography, but he's killing it for us.
We've almost watched as many movies about this gentleman as we have about Tom Hanks.
Or Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Yeah, those are our
those
big
are
ones.
Big ones.
Those are our big two.
I was trying to think of a gal we see a lot, but you're pretty good about mixing it up. Drew Barrymore has had a couple.
Oh, yeah, at least 2.
Yep. Now, they shot this film at the 20th Century Fox building. You know that big building that you see clips of from the outside, the building that takes place in, and there's nothing around it. It's a huge building.
Yep.
That's actually 20th Century Fox's own building. And they're the studio that made this film, so they just did it right in the lobby of their own studio. It's pretty slick.
Cutting corners, very good.
Cutting some corners. And it filmed in Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what did we learn about Los Angeles from this movie?
Dirty. The sun is very bright at the end of the day.
Yep.
It looks like the sky was like reddish orange.
Yeah,
a lot
for sure.
Of smog in the air.
Yep. He even said, he says a couple things about Los Angeles in this movie, too.
There's like some ladies that he checks out and he's like, oh, L.A.
Yep. And then
something
he has something, too, where... He's like talking about like how something's gross, and he goes, "Oh, Los Angeles," and then he has a moment where somebody kisses him on the cheek.
Oh yeah, a random guy at the party like says, "Hey, Merry Christmas," because it's a Christmas movie, and he kisses him on the cheek, and he's like, "Los Angeles,
California, Jesus, fucking California."
And in my head, I was like, "What does that mean? Is that like?" Everybody in L.A. is gay.
Los Angeles.
Bunch of gays.
Go get kissed on the street by a full-grown man. Yippee-ki-yay.
I love it if he just threw yippee-ki-yay in random spots.
Well, why wouldn't you? I mean, it's such a gold line.
Oh, it
it's
is.
It's like probably top 100 best quotes of all time.
Yeah.
It's probably on the
I'm
list.
I'm sure it's on that like most memorable quotes of all time from films, like AFI list.
Yeah.
I should have looked that up, but it's probably a thing.
It's all right.
Now, there's a couple of scenes like where they had to do some funky stuff. So there's a scene where he looks down and he sees the city, right? Like from way up high.
Mm-hmm.
And that, like when he's going to rappel down with the fire hose,
yeah.
I know it's one spot. That whole like backdrop, that's like that wasn't the actual city, obviously. It was just like a huge backdrop that they made, 20th Century Fox made. They've used it for multiple films. It's so enhanced and like crazy that they have moving traffic lights on it.
Ooh.
They are traffic lights that change lights.
Uh-huh.
They have like moving like lights that look like cars.
Mm-hmm.
And then they can change it from day to night.
Whoa.
On the backdrop.
I mean, that would come in so handy. You think about all these action movies in L.A. That's probably, honestly, why all these movies take place in L.A. One, because that's where everyone lives. But
they
two,
got the backdrop.
Because the backdrop. Where should we sit? Should we do New York? No.
No, LA's, we have to fly out that backdrop.
L.A.'s got the backdrop.
Yeah. We have to put the backdrop on a boat. It has to go down to Panama. And it has to come all the way up if we want to do it on the East Coast.
Is it that big?
I don't know. Now, another part where Rickman's falling to his death.
Spoiler.
Oh, sorry, everyone. I'm so sorry.
Oh, my gosh. Hans Gruber falls to his death.
When the bad guy gets his comeuppance, there is a scene where you see his face, like, as he falls, right?
Yes.
Like, he undoes the watch for his wife, and he flies off of her hand. And he has a stunt double right behind him that's, like, grasping him.
Mm-hmm.
And they had, like, planned. They're like, okay, we're gonna let go and do this fall onto this big drop. We're going to do that on the count of three.
Uh-huh.
Well, the filmmakers tricked Alan Rickman.
Oh.
They told the stunt guy, go on two.
Oh.
Like, he won't be ready
so
for
that
it.
You can get his face.
So I can get an actual facial reaction
of
terror. Surprise and terror.
Oh, what's happening?
Yep. And so I watched it too today. I was like, ooh, yeah, that's good. That's a good
tip.
See,
I think you can trust Alan Rickman to just be good, but I do like that tidbit. That is fun.
Yeah. There's also some of these moments where Bruce Willis is running around with his bare feet, right?
Yeah, he doesn't have shoes on for the whole movie because
he
has jet lag or something like that. This was a random scene at the very beginning, and the guy he's sitting next to is like, cure for that is take your shoes off and rub your bare feet in carpet or something like that.
Ball your feet and toes into fists and rub it in the carpet.
Yeah.
Makes you feel great.
So you see him, like, you know, during the party, like, kind of freshening up and doing that. And then that's when all chaos ensues. And he doesn't
have
shoes.
He doesn't have a shirt. He doesn't have time to put the shirt on.
No. Why would he do that?
Because it's cold in the AC building.
Nah.
So they actually made him prosthetic feet to wear over his own feet to protect his feet while he was running around.
Honestly, that's a really good idea.
It is.
Because I just don't know how else you would do half the things that he had to do barefooted.
Mm-hmm.
And I forgot that he was barefooted for a lot of it until one of my favorite cringiest scenes is when he's get all that glass in his feet.
Yep.
Ooh.
He's trying to pull it out in the bathroom when he's talking to Al.
So great.
Yeah.
Oh.
That scene is good.
So bad.
Well, and I think it shows, like, how smart Alan Rickman is too, because he's like, shoot the glass.
Oh, yeah.
You know, he did that on purpose.
See,
like, he can't go anywhere because
he has
bare
feet. He's so smart, I didn't even catch that.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah, he didn't say shoot the glass just to freak him out. He's like, yeah, get glass all around him because he's barefoot. He won't run.
Yeah, that's
smart.
Right. Gosh, a little genius.
So wise.
A little evil genius, Rickman.
What is this? That's what I wanted my Hans to
be like.
It wasn't
even that good.
We will find you.
Shoot the glass.
Shoot the glass now. But even his little cronies didn't talk in good German.
Well, they didn't have German things to say.
Super basic one,
Marcoli. Super basic.
Without, do me that over there.
Danke.
Nine.
Yeah, nine.
Oh my gosh. So the film gets released. When do you think it came out? What time of year?
Christmas.
Sorry, Hans. Wrong guess.
Wrong. What?
It came out.
Thanksgiving?
Nope. Keep guessing.
The summer?
Yeah.
Why?
July 15th.
No!
Like the dead heat of summer.
Why would they do that? I mean, I know it's a big blockbuster, but, like, you can do blockbusters around Christmas
Lethal
time.
Lethal Weapon was the same the year before. I think that came out in 87, I'm pretty sure.
And that came around
that
Christmas?
That came out, no, around summertime. And it's also a Christmas movie.
Oh, yeah, I guess technically.
It takes place at Christmas as well.
It takes place at Christmas. Now, I don't know between the two of them which I think is more of a Christmas movie. Maybe this one a little bit more.
I think this one, because there's more Christmas music. There's more talk about it being Christmas.
I think there's probably five times people say Merry Christmas, so I think this counts a little bit more.
Lethal Weapon takes place at Christmas, and you see Christmas lights like around the house, and it decorated that way. But you really don't, they don't talk about it being Christmas a whole lot.
Not really, no.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah.
Well, this movie comes out in 1988, a year after Lethal Weapon.
Okay.
And also in the summer, not during Christmas.
Not
Does
Christmas.
That change anything about your reflection of it being a Christmas movie?
I mean, yeah, I don't like it. It makes me sad. It's like, if you want me to go up to bat for you for being a Christmas film, then at least do me the honor of coming out at Christmas so that I don't have to look like a fool in front of people that I try to convince.
You sound mad now. You sound
vindictive
about
I feel a
how
little,
they treated you.
A little bit. I could have been really embarrassed by someone telling me this fact that you're telling me right now.
Yeah. Been like, oh, you think Die Hard's a Christmas movie? Don't you know it came out on July 15th?
Yeah. Oh, I can just hear them.
You're an idiot, Rach. Oh, hey, everybody, look at this girl. Look at what an idiot she is.
Oh, it's happening.
Now, this movie cost $28 million to make. More than Lethal Weapon.
Mm.
This is where I'm going to compare it to Lethal Weapon a lot.
Yeah.
More than Lethal Weapon. And it made over $80 million. Less than Lethal Weapon.
Oh.
Something to think about.
Something to think about. Is it because it didn't have two big headlining people?
I mean, you say that, but Donald Glover, besides like Color Purple, hadn't done a whole lot either at that point.
Yeah, that's true.
His like star was really going to rise after Lethal Weapon.
Mm-hmm.
And Mel Gibson wasn't the star, that huge of a star either.
Hmm.
So, I mean, I guess more than Bruce Willis, though, because he was in Mad Max.
Yeah.
The movie releases. It never takes the top spot. It actually never even gets the second spot during the box office.
Wow.
When looking at the box office receipts.
Huh.
It's at number 3, but it stays in the top 5, though, for 11 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
Now, here are some of the other movies that like continuously beat it out, so it wasn't able to.
Mm-hmm.
Who Framed Roger Rabbit?
Oh, love it. Love that film.
Yeah.
We'd love to do it, but I think
we've both
seen it
quite
so.
A bit. But it'd be fun.
I'd be curious how appropriate and or inappropriate.
Oh, I don't think it is. Doesn't he have a part where the rabbit goes like into Jessica Rabbit's like cleavage?
Oh, I'm sure.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure. And he like sticks his head out.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, I don't think it would be appropriate anymore.
I saw it a lot of times at my babysitter's.
Yeah, I did too.
I don't know.
Like, that movie should be rated PG-13, but I don't know if it is.
At least.
I think it's probably a PG
movie.
It's
an 80s PG.
Yeah, 80s PG.
80s PG.
Yeah, we can get away with so much. Yeah, mom, who cares?
Just one.
Maybe show one butt. A couple other movies that were out around that time. Coming to America.
Okay.
Have you ever seen that movie?
Mm-mm.
No, it's a...
I know enough about it, but yeah.
Eddie Murphy
hit.
I've seen it, but I don't really remember much about it, and I don't remember thinking it was very good. But I haven't seen it for a long time, so maybe it's great. And then, Cocktail. Do you know who's in Cocktail?
Tom Cruise?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. I watched the trailer for it today.
Yes?
It's freaking weird.
Yeah?
It is not the movie I thought it would be. I figured it was like a male version of Coyote Ugly. You know, like making cocktails, having love, having fun, dancing and partying. That's what I thought it would be.
Oh my God. I love that movie.
Where's Coyote
that?
Ugly?
What
awesome.
Movie is that? No, this movie you were just singing about.
Oh, no, that's Coyote Ugly, the male version.
Oh,
they like sing
that's
and
what I
want
to see. I think we should see a male version of Coyote Ugly. Wouldn't that be
Dude,
fun?
There's money to be made.
I think so.
Yep.
All right, patent.
Now, this movie, though. It's like dark, and it's like, everybody's out to get you in the world of corporate America. Only you're in Jamaica, and you can't trust anybody.
In Jamaica?
Yeah. Oh, you want to rise to the top? You can't trust anybody. And there's like people dying and stuff.
It sounds kind of like a noir-y.
Yeah, it is. It's kind of weird. Granted, I've never seen it. This is just based off the trailer, folks. So if you're like, Ty, I saw the movie. It's nothing like that. Well, you need to talk to the trailer, folks. Unless I'm watching one of those trailers. Have you ever seen those trailers where they're like, they make The Shining into like a family movie, or they make West Side Story into
yes.
a zombie movie. Maybe I was watching one of those.
Those are the best.
Those are really fun.
This channel is reserved for emergency calls only.
No fucking shit, lady. Do I sound like I'm ordering a pizza?
Let me go into some taglines.
Okay.
Okay. A lot of these have to do with how tall the building is. Just a heads up.
I promise I will never even think about going up in a tall building again.
All right. First one, though. It will blow you through the back wall of the theater. Second one. 40 stories, 12 terrorists, 1 cop. Third one. 40 stories of sheer adventure. Fourth one. High above the city of L.A., a team of terrorists have seized a building, taken hostages, and declared war. One man has managed to escape, an off-duty cop hiding somewhere inside. He's alone, tired, and the only chance anyone's got. Sounds like a synopsis. It's not really like,
yeah,
it's
like
not
very
like clever. Like on the poster.
Clip to the point.
That
very
is like
good.
Half of the poster.
Jeez.
All right. 12 terrorists, 1 cop. The odds are against John McClane. And that's just the way he likes it.
Yeah, it is.
I think that's my favorite.
Yeah, it is.
And then, he's the only chance anyone's got, which is similar to the other one. And then, it's Christmas Eve in L.A., and the party action's about to explode on the 40th floor. They just love talking about 40 floors.
Did I mention there's 40 floors?
Thing is, I don't remember there being 40 floors.
No.
Their party was on floor 32.
Yeah, and he goes up to, like, the steps.
He goes up to, like, 35.
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't think there's 40 floors.
Now, there were a couple above them that were in construction because that's where he hid out.
Maybe there was going to be 40 floors when it was done. They had more building to do.
They just never went to, I don't know. That seems like a hole.
But here's another thing. Here's another little hole in the whole game.
Okay.
When they show that building, and they show it multiple times from far away, the top three floors are all under construction. They should have, like, plastic wrapped, you know, like plastic in the windows fluttering, and they should have, like, construction stuff up and, like, a crane or something up there. They don't have anything. The whole building from the outside looks like it's just perfect.
But I think they're, like, it's, like, inside remodeling, right? I think the outside is
all done. The windows are done?
Yeah. The windows are all done. Everything's
The windows better be done.
Well, usually I think they're, like, the first thing to be done.
I don't know.
And then you start, like, putting up, like, drywall and things like that.
The windows aren't always some of the first stuff to be done. I've been on some of my dad's job sites. Mm. And the windows a lot of times have plastic wrap on them for a long time because you want to get the framing up. So then if you have to adjust framing or they do something with the floor plan, you don't have to take windows out.
I see.
Yep. So you want to keep those until later in the game.
Well,
That's a little tidbit for you, everybody.
I'm really glad you're here to set us straight.
Hey, and while we're on the topic, everyone should go out there and subscribe to Family Handyman Magazine.
Ty over COVID really explored that side of his personality. He just, like, dug in, and I love him for it. It's been great. We've gotten, like, three bathroom remodels out of it.
Yep.
He's jonesing to get after our basement. We'll see.
I want to do it so bad.
Yeah.
I want to do it so bad.
Is this German?
No, that was just a weird accent? No, that was just a weird thing. No, if it was German, you'd know. Rotten Tomato score, do you want to take a guess what it is?
80%?
Higher.
Oh, 92?
A little bit higher than that, even.
94?
It's at a 94%. Mm. Audience score? Same thing.
100%.
Oh, yeah, 100%.
1,000%.
Everyone agreed.
I loved all 40 floors of it.
Not everyone agreed on Toy Story 3, but they agreed on this one. 94%.
Hell yeah.
Now, here's the critics' consensus. Its many imitators and sequels have never come close to matching the top thrills of the definitive holiday action classic.
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about its sequels. And compare them to Lethal Weapon.
Okay.
And then I want you to think about this. I know you've only seen one Lethal Weapon movie.
Yeah.
This is going to suck then.
This is going to be hard.
Okay.
We can do it.
Here's where Die Hard sits. First one, 94%. Second one, 69%. That came out in 1990, by the way. So just like 2 years later, they come out with the second one. I've seen that one. It's all right. It's not bad, but it's not super great.
Do you know, like, the premise of that one?
More terrorists. There's something on an airplane towards the end. Like, that's the big ultimate action sequences on this airplane.
It's in the air?
No, it's like getting ready to take off from the landing strip, and they're like fighting around on... I think they're on top of it.
Oh.
Yeah, it's kind of cool. Maybe I'm thinking about that wrong. It's been a while, but... Then there's 59% for the third one. That's Die Hard with a Vengeance.
Yep.
That's the one with Samuel L. Jackson in it.
Oh,
yep.
Cool.
I think he plays the villain in that one.
Mm-hmm.
And that one actually made the most money.
Okay.
Yep. And then there's Live Free and Die Hard. That one came out in 2007 when we were in college.
That sounds familiar.
I've seen that one, and I think I liked it, but I don't remember much about it.
Mm-hmm.
That one has an 82%.
Wow.
That's the second highest rated one.
Wow.
Then the last one came out in 2013. I don't know if you remember this. Oh, gosh. Who's the actor who plays his son in it? He's a stupid actor. He's horrible.
Shia LaBeouf.
No. I love Shia LaBeouf, so I would have been that strong about Shia LaBeouf. No, but he's kind of like a bad version of Shia LaBeouf. He kind of looks like him, actually.
Hmm. Mm-hmm. Nope.
Okay. Oh, I don't know. He's in the Godzilla movie, too. Anyways, he's horrible. He plays the son. He got a 14%. It's easily the worst.
Mm-hmm.
It was a bad movie. I think it was up for a Razzie that year, too. Now, the Lethal Weapon movies. The first one, 80%.
Mm-hmm.
The second one, 84%.
Mm-hmm.
The third one, 60%. And the fourth one, 53%. Now, if we're playing the game of averages.
And we are.
Are we not, folks? I think we're always playing the game of averages. Die Hard comes out to a 63.6%.
Mm-hmm.
Lethal Weapon comes out to 69.3%.
Wow.
So if you're looking at the series in totality, Die Hard has the highest ranking one with the first one. But then this, it's kind of intermixed between that and Lethal Weapon. But the averages, Lethal Weapon comes out to better scores. Where do you sit on this, Reach?
Well, I guess I want to know, what does the trend line say? Which has a better trend line? Which one would be
is getting
up
better?
Or which one would be like, meow?
They're both, the trend lines are weird. Lethal Weapon, it's going steadily down.
Yeah.
And in Die Hard, it was going steadily down.
But
and then
it
2007
popped up.
And then 2013 plummeted. Like
it
a crazy plummet.
A harder one. Yeah.
So you can't really look at trend lines, I don't think.
It's tricky.
I mean, you can always look at trend lines.
I need
school
to know
psych.
All the data. Which franchise do I like better? Just basing it off of one movie of each?
I guess so. Yes. I want you to make a designation now.
I mean, I could see where Lethal Weapon would have more longevity, just the buddy cop stories.
Yes.
And I don't know if maybe, you know, Officer Carl from Step by Step comes back in Family Matters, comes back into it, or
him.
If it's always just Bruce Willis.
I think it's just Bruce Willis.
Is his love interest the same? Does his wife die at some point to
his
make way for some hot young actress?
I remember his wife in the second movie.
Okay.
But I don't know if she was in any of the others.
Mm-hmm.
She might have died at some point.
I could see where Lethal Weapon would have more going for it. They have a single hot cop as the lead, so you can always like mix and match young Hollywood starlets in and out, as one does. So I would imagine most people would say Lethal Weapon, but I think from a story standpoint, I like my Die Hard odds better.
I'm going to just make a guess what a lot of the public would say.
Mm-hmm.
I think they would say Lethal Weapon's probably the better series. Like, if you're going to watch a series, I think that's probably what you'd pick.
Mm-hmm.
But I think they would say Die Hard is the best movie out of all those movies, though,
mm-hmm.
by far.
Yeah.
I think they would say, like, no, yeah, the first Die Hard's better than the first Lethal Weapon. What do you think?
I think it
is. Oh, okay. But don't get into your scores. But yes. Are you?
I know.
Okay. Very good. Now, even though they paid Bruce Willis $5 million.
$1 million.
They did not put him on the poster for most of the posters.
Cool.
Because they thought he was not a draw. So their poster is like usually a bunch of like terrorist people, and there's like a building.
German
and then
terrorists.
There's like a very faded version of Bruce Willis that you can't even tell it's him.
Mm.
So like that's what the poster that they usually went with. Sometimes it was like a building exploding, but like it was usually not like Bruce Willis mm-hmm. in Die Hard because he wasn't a name at that time.
Got it.
Take this under advisement, jerkweed.
Bruce's sweaty, bloody, drenched tank top, Rach, is actually available to look at, not touch.
Look, don't touch.
In the Smithsonian.
Wow. That is pretty epic.
And I saw a picture of it. It's gross.
Oh, I'm sure.
It looks disgusting.
I'm sure. I mean, you know, he probably had a couple, but that is cool.
Mm-hmm.
That is very cool.
Willis used he did a lot of his stunts, but he used stuntmen a lot. He had 37 stuntmen in total.
Oh my gosh.
And I guess if you watch the movie really closely, and I looked for it, you can see the majority of these stuntmen in different shots. Like
mm-hmm.
they didn't do a super great job of hiding their faces a lot of times.
Oh.
And there's even scenes that, you know, that prosthetic foot that I told you about?
Yeah.
You can see the prosthetic foot, like it, because it kind of dangled off of his, like, costume so he could slip it on
sure.
easily. And sometimes he was in actual feet in certain scenes, and you can see the prosthetic feet just hanging there.
So
he looks like he has four
feet.
Yeah.
Why didn't you show me these scenes?
I never saw it. I was looking.
Oh, cool.
I was looking for it.
Well, you know what scene? I'm glad that you did replay for me. There was a scene as terrorists are walking into the building. First time we're seeing them, they're
they
all
look
like
so badass.
Yeah, this gang.
Germans. I hope we don't see any of the Americans for us to fight tonight.
They're all walking in behind Hans Gruber.
They're like West Side Story.
And it cuts off right before the left henchman walks into a wall.
It's so funny. So
you won't see him walk into the wall, but it happens.
But
you can tell.
Like he just nailed the wall and the director was like, damn it, we can't use that cut now.
So crazy.
Did you ever hear of the cartoon Bruno the Kid?
Nuh-uh.
I was watching a trailer of that earlier today, too. It came out in 1996. It was on for one season.
Okay.
And it was Bruce Willis. And it's weird. Do you remember that, I'm going to forget the name.
Is it live action?
No, it's a cartoon.
It's a cartoon. You said that.
But there is, there's that one show that was on, I'm going to explain it. It had very advanced graphics for like the 90s. Mm. And there were these little things that would come down and they'd capture the city and there'd be like a game that the main characters would have to win this game in order to like lift the little sphere that blocked off the city. It was all animated. They had like blue skin and then, or green skin. Okay.
Carmen Sandiego.
Nope. Dang it. I wish I remembered the name of this TV show right now. But anyways, so they use like advanced graphics kind of like that. So mm-hmm. Bruce Willis is like this weird, he doesn't fit into like a normal cartoon, but the cartoon kid's talking to like this Bruce Willis character. Mm-hmm. And he voiced both himself and the little kid. So I don't know. This is weird. And Bruno, I guess, was like his childhood name and stuff.
Okay.
And so he made this little cartoon. And he spent a lot of money on it, and it lasted for one season. Oh. Apparently, it's really bad.
Yeah, I can't wait.
So I'm going to check out.
Let's get a little sneak peek of that.
Yeah. Now, the director of this movie, Rage, thought it was very Shakespearean. Why would he say that? He said, Die Hard is a very Shakespearean movie.
I don't know.
What? I don't know.
I don't know. Why would he say that? I'm trying to think of which theme it's like.
He thought the unities of time and place and those are very Shakespeare. Well, Shakespeare shits on those. But like in general, that's like a thing for Elizabethan authors. They're only supposed to be like within 3 days and they're supposed to take place at one location. Or if you travel, you got to have these certain rules. So he tried to abide by those same unities. Mm-hmm. And so he made it was the original script called for 3 days. And he truncated all that time. He's like, no, this is all happening in one night. Mm-hmm. One spot, one night. This is like, he called it, this is Midsummer Night's Dream of action movies.
Oh my gosh. I mean, he's not wrong in the sense that having it all in 3 hours or whatever is, it's kind of cool.
I mean, it can be, but the Shakespearean thing, I'm going to contest though.
That's a bit of a stretch.
Because Hamlet, Romeo and Juliet, Mackers, those all take place in a lot longer than Romeo and Juliet's like 2 weeks, but like yes. they take place in quite a bit more time.
For sure.
I'm going to challenge you on that one. Now, Alan Rickman, he thought the guns were too loud, Rach. What did you think?
Yeah, they were too loud. Oh, yeah. My gosh. At one point, like, my ears were just, like, busting. And it wasn't like it was just, like, a one thing. Like, during the shootout, I think it was, like, a minute and a half of just machine gun noise.
Dude,
it was loud.
So the director decided to use special blanks that were extra loud because he wanted that sense of danger and just that overwhelming loudness to the film. Mm-hmm. And so Alan Rickman, every time he'd shoot these blanks, because they're so loud, and he was not used to shooting guns, he'd always flinch.
Yeah.
So in the cutting room, they always had to cut, like, right after he'd shoot somebody, they had to turn away because, like, he was flinching every time. And be like, yeah, you look really weak.
He's loud.
Bruce Willis lost 3/4 of his hearing in his left ear.
Oh, my gosh.
Yes. He
no
still
way.
Bothers him to this day. And the scene that it happened, I was like, Rach, pay attention to this scene. It's when he's in like this, the main CEO guy's office, and there's a bad guy who's on top of a table. And he's like, you should have shot me when you had the chance.
Yeah, and he says, oh, you run out of table.
Yep, Bruce Willis shoots the guy through the table.
Yep.
Next time you have a chance to kill someone, don't hesitate.
Thanks for the advice.
Now, the gun, I noticed it this last time because I was watching for it, is right up to his face. Bruce Willis is shooting the gun like right by his face because he doesn't have a lot of room to extend his arm. And he's underneath that table where it's going to echo.
Oh, no.
And so the ringing from the blanks, damaged his hearing. He never came back.
Good thing he was paid $5 million to pay for a new ear.
Yeah, cochlear ear implant.
I guess. Ugh.
Yep. Hey, we've already talked about Rickman's German accent and his American accent.
Yeah.
Rach, do you have an accent that you are especially bad at?
Yeah.
Which one?
Scottish.
Oh, yeah?
Scottish is really challenging.
Okay. Go ahead.
Which one are you really bad at, Ty?
I'm really bad at
one you're really bad
French
at?
And Russian. Oh, easily.
Which one would you like to share with us today?
Well, my Russian always sounds like this.
Can you speak Russian in this octave?
Nope, you must stay down here.
Good. What about your Scottish? Do you have
what
anything?
About it? What better about than that.
Oh, do you think so now?
He's kind of like Jabba the Hutt a little bit.
No mopping now.
What's your little Scottish guy
say? Gosh, I gotta think of what my kinesthetic trigger is. I don't want to be a princess.
Okay.
I gotta give me something else to say. Yippee-ki-yay!
That's hard because nope. Yippee-ki-yay.
Yippee-ki-yay. Okay, brother. That's a lost reference if any of you got that.
Hey, stay tuned.
You didn't, but...
Stay tuned. We might have a little surprise for you lost fans coming in the future.
Hey-o.
Yep, give us a few months.
Almost there.
Yep. Did you notice, speaking of accents, though, that everybody in this version of Los Angeles had a New York accent?
They
were all like, yeah, so what's going on in there? Yeah. Hey, we got to get somebody. We got to cut the power to the building now.
Whoa. Like,
constantly.
They did.
Like, the guy in the manhole is like, look, my boss is going to be so mad at me. And then like, the FBI agent is like, you better do this. I was like, what's going on
Where
here?
Are we?
I know Bruce Willis is from New York.
He's the only one that's allowed to
but
have that.
But he doesn't have a New York accent, really. He just talks like Bruce Willis.
Yeah, I mean, who has like a little bit of
I guess he does a little.
There's a toughness to it, so I always associate that
an
with
urban
New York.
Quality.
Yeah, but maybe it's not New York, but it sounds a little like... Nope, that wasn't it.
Sounds a little like...
Sounds a little like this, but it doesn't sound like this at all. I'll stop.
Oh my gosh. So, something to feast your ears on, that there's a lot of New York dialects going on in Los Angeles.
I guess so. Yep. No kidding.
Hey, they mentioned both Stallone and Schwarzenegger in this movie. Did you catch that?
Nope.
They had a moment
Neither.
Where I think it's Alan Rickman says something about like, you are the Sylvester Stallone of your like people. I don't know. He like mentions Stallone, I think, at one point.
Like Rambo?
And then maybe that. Hmm. And then Bruce Willis says something when he's on the walkie. He's like, yeah, there's enough C4 in here to blow up an Arnold Schwarzenegger film or something like that. So they both like make mention to these other people.
Yeah.
Do you think those were shout outs or were they disses?
I think because of who made the film, they had to be shout outs.
Yeah, they weren't pot shots.
No.
Wasn't like, let's make fun of them. Those dickheads turned us down.
No.
We're gonna get them.
I mean, Stallone, maybe. You didn't say Arnold being offered it, although I could see him doing this role very differently, too. And being Austrian and them being German has a lot of interesting themes.
Yeah, and especially when Rickman's worse at the German than him.
Or if you try to make Arnold like American, like people try to do in other movies.
Oh, American Commander.
You're American with your exits. Sorry. I'm sorry, listeners.
Oh,
I'll stop.
Oh, my gosh. Oh. Now, there's some big plot holes in this movie. I don't know if you noticed any of them.
I mean, does it have to do with how they get into the vault or anything like that? The physics of the bombs and
no,
the,
not necessarily.
None of that
I mean,
stuff?
Maybe, but that's not what I read about.
Okay.
There's two big things.
Yeah.
Number one, the little ambulance car coming out of the back of the truck. You know what I'm talking about? At the end of the movie, they brought in those big moving trucks, right?
Mm-hmm.
That they brought in at the very top of the movie.
Yep.
And then at the end of the movie, there's like a little like ambulance thing that starts to come out, like the nerdy guy who's trying to break into the vault.
Yep.
He comes out of the back of the truck.
Mm-hmm.
There, that thing is so big that there's no way it could have fit in the back of that truck, because what do we see at the beginning of the film? They open that back up and there was like 1,000 troops coming out of it from like the terrorist guys.
Oh yeah.
So
I saw that. I was paying attention.
That was done like very spur of the moment. They're like, hey, how are we gonna get rid of that one character, like the nerdy character? We need to find a death for him. And they had already started filming and they were on set and they're like, what about that little ambulance thing? Will that fit in there? And then we can have the limo driver like crash into him. So that was like all done on the spot.
Got it.
But in hindsight, it doesn't make sense because we saw a clip earlier in the film where we saw a bunch of dudes come out of the back of that
truck. I just kind of like suspended disbelief and pretended that the ambulance got there another time or just was there.
Oh, that's crazy.
I know. I just wasn't really focused on that.
Another big plot hole.
Huge.
And this is because of a deleted scene.
Oh.
When Bruce Willis first meets Alan Rickman, and Alan Rickman's doing his best American voice.
Yes.
What happens in that scene?
He asks him about his name.
Okay.
That's not what you're getting at?
No, no.
Oh, okay. Alan Rickman pretends to be a hostage.
Uh-huh.
And so then he tries to like fool Bruce Willis into thinking that he's not a bad guy. And so then they sit and they have a cigarette with each other and they're just kind of making small talk. And
what's Bruce Willis give him?
A gun.
Gives him a gun.
He gives him a gun. He said, you're going to have to learn how to shoot, but he gives him a gun, but it doesn't have any bullets in it. But we don't know that until Alan Rickman pulls a trigger.
And then he like just pretty much says, like, I knew it was you.
Yeah.
Now, how would he know it was him?
Did it have to do with a name? Because Alan Rickman gives him a name. He says, my name's Bill Clay. And you can see Bruce Willis like look up at a chart behind him, and it's got the names of everybody in the building. And he sees that there's a Clay there, and he's like, oh, okay. So I figured it was like, that's how he figured it out.
No, and that was supposed to be how he was tricking Bruce Willis. Okay. So in the original, well, they actually shot this scene, but then they cut it for time. Because the movie is long. It's like 2 hours and 15 minutes. Mm. So there was a moment in the scene where earlier in the movie, he had shot some German guys, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he looks at their watches and they all have the same watch. And actually, even before that, when Alan Rickman's coming in and all the troops are getting ready, they're all supposed to be like, all right, synchronize your watches.
Mm.
And that's a scene, too. So they have the synchronizing watch moment. They have this moment where Bruce Willis sees all these German guys with the same watch.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, that's weird. And he even like makes a comment about it. And then in that moment, he was supposed to see the watch.
Oh.
And then when he hands him the gun, it's like he figured it out.
Oh, you know what? They probably thought about the watch piece because there's a couple of other things like watch wise that were left in that don't really get their full circle. Like, so when he and his wife are talking at the beginning before the party, and like that jerk kind of comes in and he's like, you should see the watch your wife got, it's a Rolex. And then at the end when it's the Rolex that's on her wrist that Alan Rickman's holding on to, and they take it off, like there's like a lot of watch things as well. So if those are probably not related, but it would be cool if they were.
Which was that Rolex given to her by that douchebag guy?
No, it was a company thing.
It was her boss. Like, yeah, it was like a thank you, you did a great job for us. Okay.
Yep.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there's a moment that made me kind of laugh in this movie.
Just one?
Yep, just one major one.
Mm-hmm.
So they are shutting everything down, Alan Rickman and his boys, in this building. But the power's still on, right? Like, the computers all work, the elevators work. Everything, the lights all work. Everything works besides these big, like, security gates close, right? But what else happens in that shot? Gate close, windows, gates closing everywhere. Things are locking up. And something shuts down that I was like, but elevators still work, lights still work, computers still work. The escalators stopped.
Oh.
I was like,
yeah?
You're locked in here now, baby.
You're
no
not
escalators.
Going anywhere.
Those are now steps. So what was the point of that?
Yeah, you're not going down those.
We got you right where we want you.
Those are up elevators or escalators. You'll never go down those.
Yep. Good luck using the elevators. That's where we're at. Now, there's this huge debate on whether this is a Christmas movie.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll be interested to hear what you think about this. But I want to run some demographics by you.
Okay.
Some numbers. I'm a stats guy, you know.
I love it.
I took like 4 stats classes throughout my college career. A couple in undergrad, a couple in grad school. I've like taken stats so many times. Nah, that's not true. That's you. You take stats.
I'm thinking like, I don't remember this at all.
Never taken stats before in my life. Don't really know what that means. So Bruce Willis himself says this is not a Christmas movie.
Oh, okay.
Says this is a Bruce Willis movie. It's not a Christmas movie.
Oh, that's very so cocky. Bruce Willis-y.
Out of Americans that have been polled about this same question, 62% of them say it is not a Christmas movie.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's a bunch that say that they don't know for sure, but 25% say yes. Now, let's break those demographics down a little bit.
Okay.
Between men, men are more likely than women to say it's a Christmas movie. Mm-hmm. 32% to 20%.
Mm-hmm.
Males between the ages of 30 and 44 say yes at the highest rate, 37%.
Okay.
And I think everybody over the age of like 65,
it's
like under 10% say it's a Christmas movie. So it's really small. Those are the numbers. That's what America says.
What do you say? I won't be swayed by you.
I think it's an action movie that takes place at Christmas.
No, I was going to say that.
I don't think it's a Christmas movie.
I like that we call it a Christmas movie,
I
though,
do
because
too.
It kind of mixes up
I
that
do too.
Feel. Like, sometimes I love Christmas movies, but sometimes I need a little break. You know, sometimes
yeah.
I have to mix it up. And I think this would allow you to mix it up,
mm-hmm.
but still stay in that Christmas theme or movies that happen
yep.
around Christmas. But I mean, truly, when you break it down, no, it's more of like crazy circumstances that happen around Christmas.
Mm-hmm.
But maybe it's a little bit Christmas too.
But if I was ranking the best Christmas movies of all time, this isn't on the list. And not because it doesn't deserve to be mentioned with those other movies as far as quality.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't go on the list because it's not a Christmas movie in my mind.
Yeah, it doesn't have the themes of Christmas
yeah.
in
yep.
it.
So
there's no believing in Santa. There's no righting wrongs. I mean, kind of a little bit, but
yeah.
not really. International terrorism isn't really a Christmas theme that we want to focus on.
You think we're terrorists?
Oh, I'm Hans Gruber.
They're not terrorists. Rach, would you like to talk about any of your favorite scenes? Anything that you would like to bring up? Acting talk?
I'd
love
mean,
to hear about it.
I think overall it's pretty well acted. I mean,
mm-hmm.
minus the gibberish out of the Germans' foot soldiers that was happening.
Yep.
But then again, I didn't catch it either, so I guess they were good.
I think Bruce Willis is really pretty good.
I know what a TV dinner feels like.
Yeah, I think so.
Mm-hmm.
I think everyone's good in it, to be honest.
Yeah.
I think it's a good movie. Some of my favorite parts, I love the glass in the feet thing.
Mm-hmm.
Love, hate, that always makes me cringe, but it's iconic, and it always makes me think of this movie. I love when the guy, when he's running on that giant table, he says, like, run, no more table. I'm just like, it's a great little line. I like that Bruce Willis, as he's kind of like, spying on them and trying to figure out how many he's up against, he gets the Sharpie on his arm and he
yeah.
starts writing down names of
he's
people.
Smart.
Yeah, I just thought that that was really clever and very cool cop-like.
Mm-hmm. And I like it when he doesn't know what to do and he goes, come on, John, what am I supposed to do? What should
yeah.
I do? Like, he has moments where he's like talking out loud to
mm-hmm.
himself.
Like,
he's
yeah,
trying
I don't
to figure
know.
Out. He's like,
what
dude,
are you gonna do?
Dude, I don't know either.
Don't ask me. Frank Sinatra wouldn't know, that's for sure.
Oh, yeah. You just start crooning up there. Their heads would explode.
And then my favorite scene is the mind games that Hans Gruber and our McClane play with each other when they meet up on the roof
mm-hmm.
and they're like sizing each other up. And they don't know at that time that who they each are.
Sure.
I like that moment.
Cool.
A lot.
I like it.
I like it a lot.
All right. Well, I'm to your ratio meter rating unless
yeah.
you have other stuff that you'd like to chat about.
No, I'm ready.
Okay.
I'm ready.
Sweet. She's ready, folks.
Here
buckle up.
Vigo. You gave me critics consensus already, right?
Yeah, some like one of the best movies, action movies to do what it does or something like that.
One of the best action movies of all time.
I know it was 94%.
Nice. Okay.
Yeah.
I've got it. Bullets, bazookas, and brawls. Die Hard packs a punch right to your nose. Because it stings and makes your eyes water.
Oh, I get
yeah.
that, yeah.
75%.
Nice.
This falls higher for me than Terminator 1.
Oh.
And just lower than Big on my list.
Oh.
It's right in there, 75%.
Wow.
Yeah.
So I give it a 66%.
Okay.
It's right the same ranking as Lethal Weapon. Because
oh.
if I think about which movie I'd want to watch, I don't know. I don't know.
I can't answer that question.
Yep. But it's like under movies like Scarface and Terminator 1 for me.
Oh, is it?
Yep.
Okay. It's above that for me. Both
cool.
of those.
Good for you.
Good for you.
Good for you, loser face.
Good. Hope you have a good day.
Yeah, I hope you poop all over Merry Christmas.
Oh, no. Oh, we're losing it.
I don't know what to say.
Sorry, Hans. Wrong guess.
Well, yay! That's been our Christmas episode,
Christmas
folks.
Christmas episode 2020.
Yeah.
Closing it out.
Hey, put on the board what you like between Die Hard and Lethal Weapon, and then show us what Christmas presents you got.
You don't have to do that. That's
you don't
okay.
have to do anything.
Good checking in with you, listeners. Hope you guys are well, yep. And hope to see you more in 2021. We don't know what's coming, but mm-hmm. we'll keep you posted.
We'll see you for our Martin Luther King Day episode, which will be Selma. And then we'll do Groundhog's Day. Speaking of Groundhog's Day, come on, you idiots. And then we'll do a Valentine's Day episode, which will be the hit Valentine's Day.
Oh, my gosh.
And then we'll
right
do a
now.
New Year's episode. That'll be that New Year's Eve show movie with Taylor Swift in that.
I don't know.
Or is she in Valentine's Day? She's in one of those two.
I don't know.
We got to watch both of them. I hear they're terrible. They're like terrible Love Actuallys.
Oh, boy.
Rach, what's your favorite Christmas movie of all time as your sign-off?
It's a Wonderful Life.
Yeah.
Number one.
Cool.
Ball every year.
Yep.
I know how it ends, but I just cry every year.
Yep.
Yep. How about you?
White Christmas.
Mm-hmm. That's mm-hmm. my number two.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And then Love Actually is probably up there too. Those are the top three, those three that we've just talked about.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Hey, by the way, Bruce added your favorite line in the movie.
Oh, yeah.
It was totally like improv. He was trying to pop the crew and they were like, oh, that's amazing.
No
we gotta keep it. That was
way.
All Bruce Willis. All Bruce, baby.
Mm-hmm,
so
mm-hmm.
let's give a little sign off with that.
All
Only
right.
we're going to clean it up a smidge.
Love it.
All right. Yippee-ki-yay, mother trucker.
Trucker. I couldn't remember how you're
like,
ending.
Mother, oh, no. Are we going to say this?
I forgot.
All right. Let's try again.
All right.
Yippee-ki-yay, mother trucker. Rach, you pause
weird.
Again.
It just feels you pause. Weird. I don't
and
like
And the funny thing
it.
Is you keep pausing on mother. You're like, yippee-ki-yay, mother trucker.
All yeah, right. mofo.
One more time.
No,
we're going to get
we're
it.
Good. We're good. And good
Yippee
night.
Yippee-ki-yay.
Mother trucker.
Yeah.
Happy trails, Hans.
You have me at a loss. You know my name, but who are you?
Just another American who saw too many movies as a child. Another orphan of a bankrupt culture who thinks he's John Wayne, Rambo, Marshall Dillon.
Do you really think you have a chance against us, Mr. Cowboy?
Oh! Please, God, no! You're one of them, aren't you? You're one of them. Murder! Don't kill me, please.
I spent a weekend at a combat ranch. You know that game with the guns that shoot red paint? Probably seems kind of stupid to you.
Enough jokes. Yippee-ki-yay, motherfucker.